Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the session one of the PG Update 2021. So today I will be speaking to you all about reading of corneal topography. As you all know, corneal topography basically is one of the important armamentarium of the clinical diagnostic tools. Most of us use it. Let's see what is the scope of the image reading. Topography basically helps us to know what is a normal cornea. It helps us to differentiate an abnormal pathological cornea and to also differentiate a deviation and artifact. Topography is a diagnostic tool in picking up of ectatic corneal diseases like keratoconus, PMD, and it has been one of the holy grail as a screening tool for patients in whom we plan for refractive surgeries, where we pick up and find out who are not fit for this. Topography is used as a follow-up tool in patients with progressive keratoconus, in deciding when to do the patients for C3R, as well as to follow up for the stability of the same. Topography as an assistive tool is used when we plan for selective suture removals in case post-keratoplasty, planning for toric incisions, as well as for limbal relaxing incisions. Broadly, topography is based on two principles, one the elevation-based and other the reflective-based. Today, I'll be exclusively discussing only on the elevation based and that also the pentachem based variant of corneal tomography. The pentachem works on the Schimpflug image principle, which states that if you need to take a high focus image of a particular point or the elevation point, the three planes, that is the focus plane, the lens plane and the film plane should intersect at a point. So the camera actually of the Schimpflug captures within 2 seconds, 25,000 elevation points, and this is later converted by the computer using the principle of triangulation and prepares a mathematical display sheet. So the pentachem display sheets are multiple. What are most important is the chord map, which is a refractive map, which is broadly used for screening for the patients, and the Bellin embryos enhanced ectasia display, as well as the pachymetric map. These three are the ones which I'll be discussing in detail. You would see a map like this and some of you would actually get scared seeing the numerical data. The first principle is a map has to be always read together, but it has to be understood in parts. So today we will understand it in parts and then try to put it together to get a sense of what a topography means. So first we'll see the statistical indices and then we'll look into the curvature maps. Then we go for the anterior and posterior elevation maps. Then we look into the pachymetric map. This is the most important map, which even in exams, you would be asked to read for. Now, statistical indices, we classify it for our understanding into three groups now. One, where we look into the quality specification and Q value, then the keratometric values and the importance of the pachymetry. Now, what is QS? QS is quality specification. Whenever you are reading a map, this should show a OK. Anything which shows data error or showing a yellow or red color there indicates that the data that is being shown or displayed is not actually what is there in the patient's eye, but it is the extrapolation which the computer has done. And hence, you need to repeat such a topography. What is Q value? Cornea being aspheric, this value actually indicates the aspericity of the corneal surface. Normal aspericity is in the range of minus 1 to 0 that we call as a prolate cornea. Whenever it becomes lesser than minus 1, it is called hyperprolate, usually seen in ectatic diseases. And when it becomes a plus value or more than 0, usually indicates an oblate cornea, which is more reflective of a post-ablative state like post-LASIK. So this Q value is the central 6 millimeter we look into. Once you have looked at quality is fine and how is the aspericity, we go into seeing to the K values. Here we have the K flat also called as K1 and the K steep called the K2. Here these are the curvature power of the flat and the steep meridian of the central 3 millimeter zone of the cornea. Why are these important? This is very essential when we are planning for a patient for any refractive surgery. The laws of the case which are used here is any time post-refractive surgery, whether it is a myopic ablation or a hypermetropic ablation, the corneal K should not become flatter than 34, or after hypermetropic, it should not become steeper than 49. Any of these two extremes will lead to a cornea being very, very unusual, and patient will have high optic aberrations and patient's quality of vision is not good. The axis which is shown here, that is the astigmatism, is the one which is a topographic astigmatism, always to be compared with the manifest astigmatism through refraction. So flat K and steep K to be looked for. What is K mean? This is the average curvature of the anterior surface of the central 3 mm zone of the cornea. And how is this important? Any mean K which is less than 40, usually the chance of having a free flap complication in a refractive surgery when we are trying to do either the conventional LASIK or the femto. Whereas the K mean, if it is more than 46, the high chance of betel holing. So these two give us an idea whether we are in for any such complication, and inappropriately we have to be avoiding these kind of cases. So after this, let's look at the pachymetric indices. Pachymetric indices are the ones which are the most important to screening ictitic diseases. First thing you should know is a cornea which is less than 470 in every other aspect of topography being normal is a thin cornea. But a cornea which is 500 microns but has some topographic changes is also a thin cornea. Second thing is the difference in thickness between the thinnest location on the cornea and the pachy should be always less than 10 microns. If this difference between the pachy apex and thinning is more, then it also indicates that there is a thinning disease. The difference between both eyes, it's not map of a single eye which is important, but comparing the two should always be less than 30 microns. There's an X and Y coordinate here, which actually shows how much is the displacement of the pachy, which is usually a concentric cornea. So if anything which goes more than 1 millimeter is abnormal. And if there is a negative sign, it indicates actually an inferior displacement of the corneal thinning. A K-max, which is shown here, is an average of overall curvature of the cornea. If it is more than 47, or the difference between both eyes is more than 2 diopters, it is a risk factor, or there is a suspicion of an ictitic disease. So now, once we have done the statistical indices, let's go to the display maps, that is the curvature map and the elevation. In curvature maps, basically we have two. One is the axial and the tangential. The axial is also called sagittal map. It is the most important screening map we use. Here the principle of getting the single point diopters is by identifying the patient's radius of curvature at every point. And here we do a tangential line on the surface and a normal is drawn to a reference line. And it gives the color codes depending on the pattern it is creating by doing this picture. Here you will get different colors. The soft colors will be usually the blue, the yellow, the green, the red, orange are the more steeper corneas. Posterior part of axial map or tangential map always will be negative values because it acts like a concave lens. Tangential maps are actually very good, may not be for screening, but since here we are using, instead of tangential lines, we are using actually geometrical tangential circles. So any subtle change between two different points are greatly picked up. So tangential maps are very good when we are actually trying to do some kind of topo-linked surgeries, or we are trying to find out the apex of the corneal keratoconus. These tangential maps are very good. So a few of these curvature changes, which normally we tend to see, this is a symmetric bow tie, what we call, where you can see symmetrically both the sides, it is steep. Or sometimes you'll have a asymmetric bow tie with skewing. You're seeing that the superior one is actually slightly skewed from the central 90 degrees. Or you can have a horizontal bow tie, which you are able to see here. It can be with something called as, again, asymmetric, but inferior, more steep, or superior, more steep. These are different curvature maps with different patterns that are seen on a axial map. Or you can have a focal hotspot, which you are seeing here, which is very classic of an ictitic disease. You can also have patterns like this, which are called as something called crab claw appearance, also called as kissing bird sign, which is also a pathognomic sign of PMD disease. So, elevation base, that was, now we knew that, that is, we take a curvature map which is there, one of the quadrants. Elevation based topography, which is where has anterior and posterior elevation, what is this machine doing? Here a best fit sphere, usually of 8 mm, is taken, and that best fit sphere leads to the difference between the that of the patient's cornea as compared. Anything that is actually below the reference body, it is comes in negatives, as you can see here in negative points, and anything above usually comes in the positive values. Elevation-based topography is usually one of the diagnostic tool for picking up keratoconus, even subclinical. You can get like this plus and minus patterns. This is called as an hourglass normal pattern on the anterior elevation. This can come into a kind of skewing again, but abnormal patterns are like a lazy Y pattern, tongue patterns, isolated islands, or presence of a focal different colored pattern. These are all different parts in the elevation maps. But what is very essential for you all to understand is the numerical data, what are normal in anterior and posterior elevation. Always remember that posterior elevation values will be more because the curvature is a little more there. So any value on the anterior curvature, which is above plus 15 microns, is considered to be a risk factor or it is pathological. And any elevation value on the back surface, which is more than plus 20, it is also a risk factor. A single same point on both anterior and posterior, if the difference in the two is more than 5 microns, that also indicates a risk point. Single isolated abnormal points with everything else being normal also, you should be suspicious. So what we have to remember here is a anterior elevation data in the central 4 millimeters, if it is more than 15, or in the posterior, if it is more than 20, it indicates pathological changes. Coming last to the corneal thickness map. The corneal thickness map, usually we know that the cornea is having concentric shape. And the normal difference between superior and inferior at 5 millimeter zone is usually less than 30 microns. Central and concentric is normal. So what is abnormal? Sometimes there can be a horizontal displacement. Sometimes there is a dome-shaped inferior displacement, as you see in the second picture, where you are able to see that is very typical of keratoconus. Or there can be only an isolated bell shape, which is typical of a PMD. Or it can be a uniform thinning, which you see in cases of keratoconus. The additional sheets, this includes, apart from the four quadrant, you have the bad sheet and you have the thickness profile. What is Belin-Ambrose enhanced ectasia? In some cases, when there is a very much, you know, steep cornea and we use the best fit sphere that the machine builds, the difference between the two, numerical data may not pick up subtle changes which are there, or the very, very early cases or the formiferous thing. So Belin-Ambrose came up with the thing where the central 4 millimeter optical zone of the patient's thinnest portion is actually eliminated and a new reference shape is created. This is called actually as an enhanced best fit sphere. So what they did was patient's cornea and the best fit sphere, which normally was used, is calculated, and a patient's own new referral best fit sphere is taken. The difference between these two, they found, was a key differentiator between normal and ectatic corneas. To show this page how it looks, you're able to see here 6 pictures. The first one is showing the patient's anterior and posterior with the standard best fit sphere. The second one, which you're seeing down, is with the enhanced best fit sphere created from patient's own cornea. And the last one is a difference in the two. So whenever the values are more than 12 micron difference, it indicates that yes, there is a subtle ectatic disease or there is some amount of curvature issues definitely in this patient. Coming to the pachymetric thickness special profile, this is a plotting of how is the progressive thinning or progressive thickening of the cornea from the thinnest point of this. So here the profile, usually the red line goes between the the black dotted lines, and it uniformly has a slow transition. Whereas in pathological diseases where there is a focal thinning and then normal cornea, you can see a quick slope. Classically, it is said anything before 6 millimeters of sudden moving away of the red curve indicates usually an ectatic disease. And this is seen in keratoconic or PMD patients. In PMD, actually, you get the reverse pattern of this because the thinning is extremely down. You can also get flat K patterns in these. So till now, what did we see? We saw the qualities, we saw the K values, we have seen the anterior sagittal map, we have looked into the anterior and posterior elevations and pachy maps. Also, we understood that we had to look into the BAD score if we are looking in for very subtle subclinical formiferous diseases. And Nevertheless, the most important is always inter-eye corneal symmetry or asymmetry has to be assessed with respect to the topographic curvature maps, packing differences, as they give a subtle clue to the disease. So in the last now, let us see a few examples. As I have already now told you that, you know, how it is. So this is a map. Now we first go to the QS. QS is okay. Q value is between minus 1 to 0. And the Ks 1 and K2 are okay. K max is less than 47. Let's go to the thinnest point. We can see that the thinnest point actually is 470. It's near there. If you saw this map, we know this is a symmetric bow tie. There is no much difference. Anterior float, we know by values, anything less than 12 is okay. And anything less than 17 is okay. So either of these two, we know this 15 and 20 as a cut down for pathology. So the curvature, anterior posterior fine, tachy is showing a little thin. So this is a picture of just a myopic astigmatism with a thin cornea and there is no disease. Let's see, it's bad. Bad also is normal. You see all the values are okay and it's a uniform transition of the thickness spatial profile. How about this? Now let's see, the QS is okay. Q value is nearly reaching up to minus 1 and more. It's going more towards becoming hyperprolate. And the K-max has now shooted up in this to 52.6. So this is a very steep cornea and cornea is also thin. Let's look at this map. Yes, this is a symmetric bow tie. Actually, we are seeing that inferior steepening more also and is skewing. Anterior float in the central 4 millimeters, anterior float is showing plus 25, which is far, far away from the normal. Posterior is showing plus 57. So all four quadrant maps are showing that there is a change. This is a picture of a keratoconus. In the bad also, we see that whatever you're seeing red, here actually the values are far more than plus 18. And this is what we call as the S-shaped ship. See that even before it has crossed the 6 millimeter, it has actually dipped from the normal curve what it has to be taken and it has taken a deviation. How about this? See, this is the patient's picture in February 2020. There's an isolated island of steep cornea and patient's anterior float, posterior float, as well as tachy are normal. Whenever you see only one isolated hotspot with no other parameters abnormal, have a suspicion of probably an artifact. This patient actually had a tear film artifact treated for 3-4 months and absolutely normal topography. So do not always take what is red is wrong. First look if red is really pathological or it is an artifact. A few more. Now let's see here the K values we are seeing. Here the QS is okay. K is actually flatter now. It is 37 or 38. The Q value has now shifted to plus 1.55. So this is showing an oblate cornea and not a prolate. So this is changed cornea from what normally we would have. And the K max is maintained 44.3. And we see it's totally green and light green, indicating a flat cornea. Anterior and posterior floats are okay. And the pachymetry is showing a concentric thinning of the cornea. An oblate with a thinning and also a KPD of more than 0.75. This is a post-ablative cornea or post-refractive surgery. Okay. How about this next one? Here also, it's nearly the same with K value being flat and Q values but showing a negative value. A flat cornea with a Q showing towards a minus 0.01 and a focal hotspot with anterior and posterior float showing changes should give you a suspicion of a post-lasic ectasia. Patient underwent ablation, that's why you have a flat case, mean case 40, but the anterior posterior floats are showing change and your Q has actually changed off to a more hyperprolate variant. How about this? As I had told you here, this is a classic picture of a kissing bird sign. Is this PMD? Look, when you look at the central 4 millimeters, there is a change. In the posterior 4 millimeters also, there is change in the elevation. Pachy but has central concentric change, which is not very much of a classic PMD. This is a PMD-like keratoconus, where the cone is inferior. So it gives a picture of being like a kissing bird sign. The difference between PMD and PMD-like keratoconus is the pachymetric map. Just to emphasize, I'll show you the next map. This is a PMD. See here, the pachymetric map shows a bell sign where actually the thinnest point is shifted far into the periphery of nearly 160. Whereas here also you have the hissing bird sign. So this is PMD, and that is the PMD-like keratoconus. This is a posterior float of the same patient. Just to conclude, this is another elevation-based map, but this is of the op scan, which is based on the slit scan principle. And this is about opticon. All of us at the end of this, we know how to read a map, but every machine has different parameters and has a different values as well as different indices. We cannot use an opticon to compare that of opscan. An opscan cannot be used to compare a pentacam. So pentacam maps should be compared with the pentacam maps only. And the values, if repeatedly seen and with reference, we would be able to identify, at least screen pathological disease and pick up subtle risk factors or red flags in these cases. So with this, I would like to end my talk. And I know it's a little difficult to actually finish in 20 minutes such a vast topic, but I hope I have done justice. If any queries, please kindly let me know. I would like to answer them.